Welcome to Tower Talk Business Radio, where we bring you conversations with the top business minds on Long Island and around the nation every week. Featuring expert consultants and small business owners who have found success but are also willing to share their top tips, failures, and give gritty, matter-of-fact advice based on their firsthand experience. Now, let's get down to business on Tower Talk Business Radio on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
And welcome to Tower Talk Business Radio, powered by the Nassau Community College Foundation. My name is Donyshia Boston Hill of Keeper, the brand marketing and digital agency. Along with Ray Schwartz and Michael Chung, we are so excited to bring you Tower Talk today.
We're focused on being the premier resource for business and entrepreneurship. We bring you weekly business advice, tips, tools, and services that help you grow your business. Plus, we interview top business leaders in the industry.
And helping provide you with business empowerment today is legendary DJ, VJ, the one, the only, Ralph McDaniels, CEO and founder of Video Music Box. Ralph, welcome to the show.
Thank you for making the time.
Oh, man, awesome. Thank you for having me. This is great.
And so, Ralph, I've been seeing you all over IG, on Facebook, on Twitter, you name it, talking about the Video Music Box collection. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, well, you know, we started the Video Music Box collection in 2020, officially as a nonprofit, in January of 2020. And of course, in February, March is when COVID-19 hit the United States and shut everything down. So we were hoping to have a bunch of events outside, some great experiences with the Video Music Box collection. And we had to figure out what could we do, you know, with it virtually. And so we started getting on Instagram, and we started getting on Facebook and creating some programs and just some experience that people could know what is the Video Music Box collection all about. So folks that know who I am, I started the show 1983 called Video Music Box. It was basically a music video show, but we showcased more hip hop stuff and more of the black artists, which MTV was not playing at all. Like MTV was not interested in any type, anything other than rock and roll at that time. And maybe Michael Jackson. And that was it. And so we said, look, this is a great opportunity to play music that I like and that I grew up with. And I started playing these music videos and started doing interviews and going out and getting performances of artists wherever I could, you know, at the time in the 80s. And people started watching it, and it became like a kind of word of mouth thing. Like, yo, did you see what was on Video Music Box this week? And people would come home and run home after school and go watch Video Music Box. So we have all this great content from 1983 till now to 2021. And we started digitizing everything because a lot of the tapes back in the days, I said tapes, people don't even know what tapes are anymore. So they were on analog tapes and we wanted to make them digital so that people could look at them online, search them, do research for if you're looking to find out more about a group from the 80s or the 90s or the early 2000s, you could go and go to our website and through our Video Music Box collection, we reached out to the public and say, look, this is a lot of work. We need help. You know, this is a big, big venture for us and we need help. And it's a nonprofit organization. You can donate to 501(c)(3), you get a write off on it. And people have been supporting us. So we need, but it's a million-dollar project, literally. And we need more support. And we need people to just come on out and help out. It's our history.
Absolutely. And it's my understanding you have over 20,000 hours of tape, interviews, you name it. You being in the scene, in the clubs, interviewing some of, you know, hip-hop's legend and most influential people on the scene.
Absolutely. Yeah, over 20,000 hours. And I forgot some of the things that I've done, you know, for so long. And, you know, it's not just even the artists. Sometimes it's just regular people in a club talking and it's funny, you know, and you see what we used to wear in the '80s and the hairstyles and the sneakers and the earrings and all of that kind of stuff. And, you know, so I find it to be like a time machine in a way, you know, because I go back and I look at some stuff and I say, wow, that area in Brooklyn doesn't exist anymore. There are just a whole bunch of buildings there right now, especially Brooklyn's landscape has changed so much, you know, and in Manhattan, a lot of the clubs that we used to go to, they don't exist anymore or maybe something else. It really tells a story and connects the dots on the history of New York as well as hip hop in the last 30, 40 years.
And when you talk about stories, you talk about clubs, you're talking about Bentleys, the R. I mean, I can go on and on and on. I don't want to date myself. So
you're young to be there. What you know about those places, Donyshia?
I don't know absolutely anything. Absolutely nothing. So talk to us a little bit about the licensing. That's key. And I know Mike wants to jump in here because he has a whole load of questions. So can people license your content?
Yeah, people can license. That's more on the profit side. The nonprofit side is not licensing. It's more subscription. It's really set up for universities to I went to school for journalism. So I was like, you know what? I would like to go back to my college where I graduated, New York Institute of Technology in Westbury, Long Island, and say, hey, to, you know, the journalism class or the communication students, you know, if you're interested in hip hop or just, you know, music in general, you can take a look at our archives and learn from it and, you know, make it whatever you want to make it. But at least it's a place for research where you can research what was happening in real time, you know, at that moment. Sometimes we see clips in documentaries and they just show you like 5 seconds of something, you know, where I have a whole, you know, maybe 10 minutes of a situation. So you see the behind the scenes as well as what was happening in the front of the stage. But as far as licensing, people do license from me all the time. Most of the hip hop documentaries that you see on TV, on HBO, Showtime, you know, Netflix, most of those documentaries have something of Ralph McDaniels' collection in it. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, just circling back to that, you know, you mentioned that you started journalism, you know, being in studying journalism. I mean, I would think that, you know, it's very facts and research oriented. Would you say like those roots is what kind of grew and expanded into you preserving and helping preserve like the hip hop culture and, you know, much of like the New York culture that I feel like, you know, I grew up in personally? Would you say that played a strong was it like a strong factor in what you are doing now?
Absolutely. You know, I grew up watching, besides the music programs I would watch, like Soul Train and Dick Clark's American Bandstand and a couple other shows, I used to watch the news, you know, and I would watch, you know, back then, you know, we didn't have a lot of channels like we have now. So we might have ABC, CBS and NBC. And no, you don't even think Fox was there in the beginning. And so I would just be, you know, anytime there was a African-American reporter, I would be like, oh, wow. You know, and I would study that person, you know, and just be, you know, like kind of infatuated with how they presented it, you know, how it was, and not just on TV, but on radio as well. I used to listen to the radio and, you know, and some of the early pioneers of radio, like Frankie Crocker and Vaughn Harper and Ken Webb, you know, I would listen to those guys and women and say, hey, you know, like this is the way it should be presented in these type of formats. And I, you know, I took a little bit from everybody and that's how I created Video Music Box.
And, you know, yeah, I do remember, like, I know, like, historically, I know, like, the roots or like the evolution, like the beginning of the evolution of hip hop culture. I mean, I would say, would you agree that, you know, it started like probably like in the early 70s, but I feel like the explosion, like the real explosion of it really kind of happened in the 80s where people were starting to notice this, this culture just expanding and having its like own identity and really defining, like you said, New York culture. Was this like originally like a passion of yours? Like, were you always into hip hop, or is this what kind of drove you to, hey, listen, you know, I want to start collecting all this videos and artists, video footage and interviews that DB mentioned earlier? Is that what really kind of gave you that passion?
Yeah, absolutely. I wanted to, I think it started off with me. My uncle used to buy records, vinyl records. And I was young and he would come home and he would have the vinyl records in a bag. And I'd be like, can I open up the bag and see what you bought? You know, I would be like, I couldn't wait for him to. I'm like, when is he going to open up the bag? And I'll be like, can I open up? And I was just like, you know, mesmerized by the vinyl. And I would look at it and I would read the who produced the record, who wrote the record, who published the record, where it was recorded at, what label it was on. you know, what artists might be featured on that particular. I was into all of that, you know, like I was reading everything that I could read on vinyl, which really sucks now because you don't have nothing to read. It's just a file or, you know, a streaming, you right. know, but I learned a lot from just reading the credits on the vinyl and on the album covers. And so, you know, I collected them just for that reason back then, album covers. And so, you know, as time went on and I started getting into video, it was kind of like the same process, you know, like, let me collect this video. Let me shoot this video. Let me title this is what it is. And, you know, and make sure that it's preserved in some way. And we've been doing it since 1983, but not in the way we're doing it now. So now it's much more like high end. We really looked at what NFL Films did. We looked at what Getty Images does, and we kind of modeled what we're doing on a lot of their practices.
You are listening to Tower Talk Business Radio on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC. My name is Donyshia Boston Hill, along with Michael Chung, and our guest today is legendary DJ, VJ, and hip-hop pioneer Ralph McDaniels, CEO and founder of Video Music Box. So Ralph, the Video Music Box collection, I mean, that in itself, I just can't imagine, you know, we talked about 20,000 hours. You're talking about the storage unit and the storage space that you must have. And the fact that you were recognized by the Smithsonian, I mean, that in itself is just takes, you know, your brand, which, you know, we all love and adore, but takes it to the next level. Was this something that you've been thinking about, or you just had an aha moment to say, this needs to happen?
No, I think it was something I was thinking about all along. I just knew it was, it's a big venture. It's like, it's not, you know, most people, when I tell them what they do, they're like, what I'm doing right now, they're like, that's a lot of work, because, you know, you're going through literally seconds of footage of content and looking at it and listening to it and subscribing everything down that's on these hours and hours of tapes, 20,000 hours worth of content. And I mean, it's not just me doing it. We have a team that's working on it now. But it's worth it to me, you know, to put the work in, to get it right. And it's also, as I got older in life, you know, I'm like, you know, we have to leave something for our family, for our legacy. And, you know, and this is part of what my legacy is. And, you know, and I don't want, if, you know, 50 years from now, people will be like, well, there's all these tapes and we don't know what it is. Well, let's do it now. And let's make sure that we transcribe everything and make sure that it's available so that it can live forever. You know, it can live in a space. You know, it's funny because the other day I was looking at this library somewhere, I think it was in California, and it was a beautiful like garden. And then the library was at the back. And I was like, well, why can't we have that for hip hop? You know, maybe it's not, you know, a garden. Maybe it's, I don't know, whatever. But
hardscape happening, some hardscape.
Exactly. A space where we can go with our kids, or kids can. I mean, I remember as a kid taking school trips to the Museum of Natural History or the Bronx Zoo. You know, I would love for there to be a place where kids can come and pull up in their school bus and with the teacher and get out, and there'll be somebody there that greets them and then take them in this big space with these huge TVs, and kids can watch visuals of what early hip hop was or what early New York City was with somebody narrating it. I'm like, hey, that'll be hot. So that's where I'm at with it.
I mean, I could definitely see that happening one day. I mean, especially now with technology and modern day learning where everything is literally visual now, right?
Yes.
So that sounds definitely like a great idea. It's something that I could definitely see it as being a realistic goal.
Yeah. Yeah. No, absolutely. You know, I would love to, as a kid, I used to love going to the Museum of Natural History, but inside the planetarium, and that was always like, I love the planetarium, you know, because you have to sit back and look at the sky, and you know, that to this day, that made an impression on me as a little kid. And if I can do that for a kid now, and you know, because it was really visual, you know, that would be dope. I like that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So when we talk about the Smithsonian and you taking it to the next level, your microphone is in there, but you're not in the hip hop section.
I know. Oh, yeah. So when the people from the Smithsonian came to me, they said, look, you know, we want to put you, you know, your hip hop, especially because I was referred by Chuck D from Public Enemy. And so they were like, you know, Chuck D told us to call you. He said, you have some great hip hop stuff. So I just assumed that I was going to be in the hip hop section. So when I went to the opening of the museum, I went in the hip hop section. I wasn't in there. I knew it was there, but I just had to find it. But they put me in TV section, which was even better. So, you know, like when you go to see Video Music Box, the microphone flag, you see like Michael Jackson when he was on the Ed Sullivan Show and other TV shows that, you know, artists made appearances on. So I was like, oh, maybe that's cool that I'm in this section over here, you know? So yeah, I'm in the TV section. So it's pretty cool.
So let's talk about some of your Video Music Box collection archive and video. You have Michael Jackson with Jay-Z at Summer Jam. I mean, you have some historical moments. We just saw you on, you know, Wendy Williams' Hot Mess. I mean, I can go on and on and on. What are some of your, you know, highlighted moments, and what can people expect from the collection?
For me, you know, like, of course, Jay-Z and Michael Jackson was a big thing backstage at Summer Jam, and DMX interviews. Anytime I talk with DMX, it was always awesome because he loved me. And he used to tell me that he used to watch me when he was in prison, and that everybody used to watch. Everything stopped. And there were no problems when you came on because everybody wanted to see the parties and the videos, and Run DMC because of my relationship with them from day one. Houdini, Queen Latifah's 21st birthday, you know, at her house with her mom and her brother who have passed away since. So many moments, so many different moments with artists. And it's really a lot of the moments when they first started, which is really kind of pure before they became, quote unquote, industry. You know, they were just regular. So I think that a lot of times it's like 50 Cent said to me, he says, you know, when I'm doing Video Music Box, I can be myself. He says, when I'm on some of these other channels, I have to be professional 50 Cent, you know. He said, but I can relax when I'm on your show. So we get a lot of those moments when people are themselves, you know. It's not pressure to say certain things or do or act a certain way. Sometimes you have to edit it out because they act too much like themselves, but but that's okay. We always, the whole idea of what Video Music Box was all about was to uplift, you know, the artists, you know, and to make them look good. I never put anything on TV that made an artist look bad. So, you know, now people look for you to look, do something bad. You know, don't let them catch you in a club drunk or, you know, out driving crazy, you know. But that was never my approach to it. It was always to make the artist look good. So if we did catch a moment where it wasn't the greatest, you know, we probably wouldn't air it. Yeah.
Now, you and I talk all the time. Full transparency, everybody. You know, Ralph and I go back many, many years. When I produced Summer Jam, I needed Ralph to produce the opening video. So I'm going to let Mike jump in here and ask a few questions. Mike, take it away.
So, you know, I think we spoke about this once, you know, about the how your work reminded me of the Schomburg collection and how Arthur Schomburg collected, you know, all the original manuscripts and all the poems of all the famous writers that we know of today, you know, most notably, you know, who can I think off the top of my head, Booker T. Washington. You know, you have Paul Laurence Dunbar. And also, I don't know if I've mentioned, but Arthur Schoenberg was also the co-founder of the Negro Society for Historical Research. Mm-hmm. So I just saw a lot of similarities in what in your work and what they did. Primarily because to that that goal to preserve, keyword preserve, the culture, because it really it gives us not only memories but it's history in itself. You know, we learn from our past, and I truly believe the work that you're doing right now is definitely going to be one. You know, in another 10, 20 years, or maybe even now already, people are looking back at it now. It's like, oh, I remember that moment. Oh, I could learn from that. Oh, I forgot about my a certain trait about myself. You know, especially during these times when it's so easy to forget as you get a little bit older. You know, sometimes you're reminded of who you were or who you used to be, maybe, perhaps. Can you give us any examples of, like, throughout your career, were there any, like, how Donyshia mentioned earlier, were there any aha moments? Were there any moments that you didn't expect were going to happen but did happen?
Oh, that's a good question. Wow. Well, you know what's interesting? When Donyshia just mentioned Summer Jam, and so when myself and Donyshia were at Summer Jam, the main personalities are Funkmaster Flex, and I'm not sure who was in the morning show. It was a different morning show, but Angie Martinez. So I come from the Flex and Angie era because they were there from the beginning. And for one Summer Jam, Angie was pregnant and she was about to have a baby. So I remember that either she couldn't be there or there was something that we had to do. And I had to go to Angie's house. Angie's pregnant in the house. And I had to get her to do a shout out or something. And so I went to Angie's house and she did the shout out and I think we played it on the Summer Jam screen or something. I don't remember exactly what we did, but you know, those were the little moments. And now like I look at Angie and sometimes she posts up this picture of this young kid.
Oh, that's huge. Yeah.
Right. And I'm like, wow, that's the kid that was in when I went to her house back then. And so, you know, those are like cool little things, you know. And I don't even know if Angie was like, you know, like she was in pregnant mode. I don't even know if she even remembers that all even happening. But, you know, those type of things, you know, you watch, you know, I mean, I knew Angie when she was an intern, you know, driving, you know, the bus. You know, and I watched her become a huge radio personality, you know, in New York City. And the same thing with Flex, you know, watching Flex, you know, he used to DJ my parties before he was on the radio. Like, I'd be like, okay, we're going to get Flex, or we're going to have DJ Ace, and we're going to have DJ Lance. And that was my rotation of DJs that I used, you know, before these people became, you know, huge stars. So, you know, watching the growth of people, is always awesome. Watching the growth of artists in general is great. It's always, there's so many aha moments, you know, that I just go, I'll tell you another thing. Like I remember when we were doing, you know, radio at Hot 97 and it was primarily like Black and Latino. And then I remember when it changed to a crossover audience and it was a lot more white people. And, you know, and we came out on the stage and, you know, before it was just Black and Latino. And then you looked out in the audience, you just saw maybe 50% mixed. And I was like, so are we supposed to say the same things that we've been saying all along? So, you know, or are we supposed to change up are we supposed to sound like Z100 now? You know, and I was like, hey, I'm going to say the same thing. I'm like, yo, where Brooklyn at? And everybody went crazy. So, you know, those moments, you know, we keep those on in our memories. And like, I like what you said is that it's personal memories for people that really is what inspires me. You know, when I see somebody go, oh, wow, I was there that night, or I was there with my friend. I did a shout out that night. Ralph, do you still have that? You know, those little things like that are pretty awesome.
Totally agree. You know, and it's so inspiring to hear what you're doing. And, you know, I feel like a lot of our listeners could learn and reflect on many things in our lives, especially, you know, during these, you know, unprecedented times, if you will, where I feel like it's really important to learn about ourselves and also a reality check and a reminder of who we are. So for those who are listening to Tower Talk Business Radio, my name is Michael Chung, along with Donyshia Boston Hill on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC. And thank you so much, Ralph McDaniels. We'd like to thank you, everyone. This is our CEO, founder of Video Music Box.
Yes, that's right. So everyone that's listening, the Video Music Box Collection, Ralph McDaniels, you are family to so many artists. And we, you know, artists in front of the camera, behind the mic, in front of on the stage, and for you to preserve that culture, our culture, and is just priceless. And you know, we wish you all the best, all the luck in the world. So, how can people contact you? How can they donate? How can they get involved in the Video Music Box Collection project?
You can go to videomusicboxcollection.org. Look at what we're doing. You'll see our mission statement, how we're working with the community, the things that we're doing. You'll see the progress of what we're doing. And also you can get in contact with me. There's a contact and it goes directly to me. It's ralph@videomusicboxcollection.org. And so we read everything. If you want to donate, please donate, because we need the help. You know, this is hours and hours and hours of stuff. And it's expensive, you know, to get these things in the format that we're doing it in now. And so, you know, whatever you can do, it's tough times. I understand that. You know, we're looking to partner with people that can help us out in some way. So we're open, you know, to listening to what folks are doing.
Right. And you're not taking like the old school flyers or hats or things of that, but you can kind of point them in the right direction if they have some of those items, right?
Yeah, yeah. Folks that do have that stuff, please don't throw it away. There's a museum that's coming in 2023 that was looking for that. So if you do have that kind of stuff, yeah, you can hit me up and I'll point you in the right direction.
Absolutely. And so, Ralph, you know, just from all of hip hop, you know, I'm a little part of hip hop, including, you know, growing up in this. We appreciate you so much. And we want you to get every single minute, every single hour out of your house, out of the storage, digitized. And we want you to just do big things, and we want all your dreams to come true. So we know you visualized it and you're making it happen. And that's just so awesome.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. And, you know, look, I'm looking for the next Ralph McDaniels, director, producer, whoever's out there. Come on, let's do it.
Fantastic. Mike, you have any final words for Ralph?
Thank you again. You know, just wanted to really touch out to our listeners today that, you know, it's not just doing good work, but the only way to make good work last as long as it has for you is really the passion, your roots, and most importantly, to truly believe in what you do. And I think that's really inspiring and definitely a quality of you, Ralph, that a lot of us can learn from. So I applaud you for that. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you for what you do. This is history right here. Thank you.
Absolutely. I'm going to give you a little bit of DB's philosophy. If you can visualize it, you can dream it. It can be a reality. Make a video and do big things, a la Ralph McDaniels, Video Music Box, the Video Music Box Collection. Thank you so much, Ralph.
Thank you.
We want to thank you for being with us today. My name is Donyshia Boston Hill, along with Ray Schwetz and Michael Chung, your co-hosts and producers. This is an NCC Foundation Business Leaders Council production. Visit ncc.edu/WPHC. Available on iHeartRadio, as a podcast on iTunes, Android, and Spreaker. This has been Tower Talk Business Radio, powered by the Nassau Community College Foundation. On the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC. We'll talk to you next week.